At 8 years old, S. Truett Cathy had succeeded reselling Coca-Colas in his neighborhood for a nickel a bottle profit. After high school and a tour of duty in the Army, he partnered with his brother to open a restaurant. This fulfilled his lifelong dream of having his own business. Despite his early entrepreneurial success, not even Cathy could imagine one restaurant could turn into a chain of almost 700 quick-serve chicken restaurants in 32 states in Canada. In 1994, Chick-fil-A recorded sales of $451 million and its 27th consecutive annual sales increase. A deep care and respect for his people is evidenced in the turnover rate of employees, which is one-fifth the national average. S. Truett Cathy's caring and developing character in young people also extends well beyond the workplace. He has established 5 foster homes for children called Windshape in Georgia, Tennessee, Alabama, and Brazil.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, with me now is the founder of the Windshape Foster Care Program and, of course, the founder and chairman of Chick-fil-A. He's a dear friend. We're delighted to have him back. Would you please welcome to the 700 Club, Mr. S. Truett Cathy. Very good to have you back with
us today. Thank you,
Pat. 50 years! 50 years! I know that, you know, we have a different audience and they've heard your story, but how did you start with this Chick-fil-A? And what is Chick-fil-A? So people know it's now a $500 million company.
Yeah. Well, it's a boneless, skinless breast of chicken served on a hot, toasted butter bun.
That's
it? I'm sure you're treating yourself.
Oh, they're delicious, absolutely. Yeah. But why that?
Well, I've been in the restaurant business, as I mentioned, 50 years, and I guess I'm the only one to receive the recognition of being in the restaurant business at the same place for 50 years.
Yeah, yeah.
And so we're doing a lot of things to commemorate our 50th year in business. Chick-fil-A is a product that we originated in my little small coffee shop type place that we call the Dwarf Grill. But we started it, we saw them, it was gaining momentum, so it led us to operate our first shopping center location back in 1967.
And well, you come up and you say, well, there's an automobile, I need to get a tire to put on it, or a battery or something. How come a boneless breasted chicken, whatever made you think that was the sandwich that you would put into a shopping center?
Well, my friends remind me, Troy, there's nothing so great about taking the bone and skin out of a piece of chicken breast and putting it between two pieces of bread, serve it as a sandwich. I said, well, I realized just a simple idea.
Yeah.
That's the reason I was able to do it. It was just a simple idea. We tried to, and did, establish a business just around this boneless breasted chicken sandwich.
Well, did you ever believe, I mean, you're up to close to $500 million a year. Did you ever think that would happen? Did you ever dream that high?
Well, I had dreams of having a chain of restaurants until I had two, and then I suddenly realized I had plenty of restaurants.
Two is
it? And oftentimes wish, you know, I could just have one and concentrate on it. So the Lord took care of that for me. One burnt to the ground. So soon after that, I started Chick-fil-A. And so sometimes these disaster things that happen to you work into being a blessing to you.
Do you own all these yourself, or are they franchised out to other people?
Well, up until a short time ago, we did own all of them. We have a unique arrangement where we lease these out to individuals. Two things important in business is capital and management. Mm-hmm. And fortunate me having a background of business, I had the capability of borrowing the money that I needed to grow at the pace I wanted to grow. So we tap a market, those individuals who have a lot to offer a business, yet financially not able to be involved in a business. So we have a unique arrangement where we lease these units to individuals.
Mm-hmm.
But since that time, we have gone into now schools and hospitals working with contract feeders, which they are franchised. College students now are looking for something more than turnip greens and cornbread. They're looking for name brand foods.
Yes, they are.
So that's where Chick-fil-A fills in. They're doing the same thing that the shopping centers have been doing, creating a food court where you go into places like Georgia Tech and Emory and other major schools that they have a choice of what they want to eat because they've been brought up on name brand foods.
Sure.
And Chick-fil-A is among those.
Well, how wonderful. Well, now, I remember when you were here some time ago that you used to reward your top managers with a brand new Cadillac or Lincoln or something. It was a brand new car. You still do that?
Oh, yes. We tell our operators, you know, you might not like to drive Lincoln Continentals, but they look nice sitting in your driveway. if you don't, might impress somebody.
Yeah.
But now, that was for 40% increase in sales.
Uh-huh.
And back in 1983, we awarded 46 automobiles that year.
Goodness gracious.
We had such a terrific year that year. And now we've dropped down to a 30% increase in sales. They get a $20,000 Ford automobile, and they can choose what they want.
So they're not getting a Lincoln Continental anymore, but that's still a very, very good prize.
Just got out of our class, and so 40% increase in sales, almost unheard of now.
Well, my secretary was talking to me just before this program. She said, I know a lot of people who go to Chick-fil-A because of a couple of things. Number one, you don't open the businesses on Sunday. Everybody right. else does. And secondly, you run by Christian principles, and people know that. Tell me how that works.
Well, we see no conflict between biblical principles and good business practice. The Bible tells a lot about how to operate our business if we just read it and apply it. And so closing on Sunday is a decision that I made back in 1946 when I opened my first restaurant. Mm-hmm. This is a 24-hour operation, 6 days a week. And my brother and I made a decision at that time that we'd just close on Sunday. I guess it's because after you work 24 hours a day for 6 days on the stretch, you need a break.
Well, I imagine the pressure's been unbearable, though. The shopping malls are booming on Sunday. They're just crowded with shoppers, right. and they say you're dragging down the averages.
Well, we think we do our part. Most of the time, we do as much in 6 days as our competition does. It's 7 days. Yeah. So that's a good argument that permits us to close on Sunday.
But you've never wavered. That took courage. It took moral courage to say, I'm going to do this.
And well, some of our shopping center developers and our lease agreement with them inject in there, they'll permit us to close on Sunday as long as we're closing all of our places on Sunday.
Okay.
So it's important that we're consistent. And so our convictions that we believe.
The most favored nations clause. you have to close all the way across the board.
All the way across the board. We never vary. And it's not even a debatable issue now.
Well, it's fabulous. You know, there's so many people who compromise. There's so much pressure. Well, oh, just a little bit, or less. Yeah. But you say no, and it's God is blessed.
Well, that's the trouble, adults as well as young people. We try to be a people pleaser to everybody, and you just can't do that.
Sure.
You have to kind of stick to your convictions, what's right and what's wrong. And we tried to do that.